Well, good morning, Mansfield Pentecostal Church, and good morning to all you online visitors who are dropping in into our online service. Hope you have a wonderful time during our time of worship and around God's Word. In a moment, I'm going to hand over to Kate, and she's going to do a kid slot for us. But before we do that, I'd just like to read to you a quote. It's a famous quote. You may have heard this before, and it says this, that the two greatest days in your life are the day you were born and the day you find out why. The two greatest days of your life, the day you were born and then the day you find out why. You know, God has a purpose for your life. I believe that it is God's desire that you should leave a mark of greatness in your world as you serve his purpose in your generation. You know, I recently heard Nicky Gumbel say this, that he said that your purpose is more important than property or possessions. Having more is no substitute than having something to live for. Well, I want to encourage you that if you don't know what your purpose is in life, I believe it starts when you make that connection with the Lord and place your trust in him. So listen, I'm gonna hand over to Kate, and now she is gonna do our kids slot. See you in a moment. Bless you, bye.
Good morning, everyone, and good morning to all the young people watching today. I just want to ask you a question. Are you good at running? When I was younger, I used to be okay at running. Not the fastest or the slowest, just kind of okay. Now I would be absolutely terrible at running because I'm not very good at running anymore. I have not done it for a long time. But have you ever tried running at school? Maybe you're really good at running in a race, or if you've tried racing your brothers or your sisters or your parents, if you've beaten them, it feels really good. So I want to tell you a little story about a runner this morning that I have been learning about this week. So it's a true story, and I watched this clip on YouTube, and I just want to tell you a bit about it. His name was Derek Redmond, and he had gotten so good at running really fast that he was in the Olympics, and he had the British record for the fastest 400 meter sprint in the Olympics, and he had won some gold medals as well. So he had worked really, really hard, and he had trained really, really hard. And in the 1992 Olympics, he was working so hard to get to this 400 meter sprint run so he could beat his own record. So the day of the run came, and all the eyes were on him to see if he was gonna beat his record and win the race. And so all the runners get ready, the gun goes off and they start running, and then all of a sudden he jumps up and starts shouting in pain, and he starts limping. And it turns out that he had torn one of the muscles in the back of his leg halfway through the race. And he stops and he kneels down and he is so upset that he starts crying because he thinks he can't finish the race. But then all of a sudden he jumps to his feet and he keeps going in the race. He's really struggling because he's in lots of pain, but he tries to keep going and finish the race. And then you see a man run out from the crowd, and he barges past all the crowd, and he barges past the security guards, and he comes to the runner, and he puts his arm around his waist and he holds him up, and he helps, and it turns out it's his dad. And he says to his dad, "I need to finish the race." So he holds him up and he helps him walk the rest of the race. And then as he crosses the finish line, it's just an amazing video. If you want to see it on YouTube, it is really good. You have got a crowd of 65,000 people applauding him as he crosses the finish line. And it just made me think of a verse in the Bible when I saw this video this week, and it's in Hebrews 12 and it's verse 1, and it says, "We all have these great people around us as examples. Their lives tell us what faith means." That's talking about all the different people in the Bible that we know about. So it says, "So we too should run the race that is before us and never quit." So that's talking about our lives as following Jesus. So we should keep running our lives to follow Jesus and never quit. Now, some days we can have good days when following Jesus and following God is really good. It's amazing. And you think to yourself, you're doing really, really well. Maybe you've read your Bible, you've spent some time with God, maybe you've seen him do some amazing things. But other days it can be really, really hard. Maybe sometimes God will ask us to do something that is really difficult. So it could be saying no to something that you know you shouldn't be doing. Or maybe it's hard when God tells us to love somebody that we really don't get on with. Maybe it's hard to talk to somebody about Jesus, or it might even be hard to try and read your Bible and pray some days. And in life, we will have hard things that come our way, and the Bible calls these trials. But what you do when these hard things happen is going to determine how you finish your race, how you finish your walk with God. So that runner that I spoke about a minute ago had lots of reasons to give up on his race. He was in loads of pain. He wasn't going to win. He wasn't going to beat his record. And he might have given up, but his dad came alongside him and he was there to help him. And that is like God in our lives. We have times where we feel we want to give up in our walk with Christ. Everybody does. Sometimes it's just too hard. And even sometimes you get to a point where you don't even know how you're going to do it anymore. But God will help you not give up, and he will make you stronger. With every hard thing that you get through, you will get stronger and stronger. Until eventually you will cross the finish line, and it won't be a crowd of people, but a crowd of angels applauding you and God waiting there with your prize. So whenever it gets tough, and whenever something is really hard that God wants you to do, if you just pray to God and ask him to come alongside you and to help you and to help you make the right choice in the situation, then God will be with you. Thank you, and I'm going to hand over to Matt.
Well, thank you, Kate, for sharing that thought for our kids' slot. I want to kind of ask you a question this morning. What, in your mind, constitutes a great person? You know, when we look at the history of the human race, it is replete with examples of people who we would regard as great. We think of the likes of Florence Nightingale, Winston Churchill, Mother Teresa, Nelson Mandela. You know, these are all people who are regarded as those who accomplished something of significance. They left a mark in history. And yet, we often think, what measures the greatness of a person? Is it their wealth? Is it their intellect? Is it the breadth of their influence? You know, where the Roman emperors were, one of the greatest fear of the Roman emperors was that they would be forgotten in history. And so what they would seek to do is they want to accomplish great feats so that their memory would last on through the ages. You know, I would say that we can all have varying opinions as to what makes greatness, what constitutes greatness. You know, there was a time in my own life when I aspired to be a great person. And, you know, as I've got older and hopefully a bit more mature, that's no longer one of my goals in life. But you see, having the goal to become a great person can sound incredibly self-centered and egotistical in the category of the Roman emperors. And yet I believe that it is God's desire for us to become great. Not for our own self-aggrandizement, but on the mark of that we leave on the world around us. You know, one day, Jesus' disciples were having an argument amongst themselves as to who was the greatest. Can you believe it? That's what they were, you know, arguing about. Who is going to be greater? Am I greater than you? You're greater than me, or whatever. And then Jesus burst their bubble when he informed them that the greatest among them was actually the least. In other words, the measure of a great woman or man is not in the depth of their achievements, but in the depth of their love for God. In fact, I believe that greatness very much is that there are many people around us, our lives, who are living great lives that actually are not, are unseen and go very much unnoticed. I think of an elderly gentleman who has now passed away to be with the Lord from Ireland. His name was Noel McFarlane. In my view, he was a great man. For years and years and years and years, he looked after his sick wife. And, you know, was an elder of a church. And in my view, he was a man who demonstrated greatness. Greatness isn't about the depth of our achievements. It's about the depth of our love for God. You know, over these coming weeks, I want us to do a new series of teaching from the first chapter of the book of Job. And this series of teaching is titled Becoming God's Showpiece. I believe God wants to show us off in front of the angels as trophies of his grace. And as Job was a showpiece of God's grace, so I believe that God desires us to be showpieces of his grace to the unseen spiritual world. I want to read to you the opening words of the book of Job. And we're going to read Job chapter 1. And I'm going to read the first few verses, verses 1 through to 5. Okay, and this is what it reads. In the land of Uz, there lived a man whose name was Job. This man was blameless and upright. He feared God and shunned evil. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters, and he owned 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, and 500 donkeys, and had a large number of servants. He was the greatest man among all the people of the East. His sons used to hold feasts in their homes and on their birthdays. And they would invite their 3 sisters to eat and drink with them. And when the period of feasting had run its course, Job would make arrangements for them to be purified. Early in the morning, he would sacrifice a burnt offering for each of them, thinking, "Perhaps my children have sinned and cursed God in their hearts." This was Job's regular custom. You know, as we look at the opening words of the book of Job, the thing that impresses me initially about Job was this statement in the first paragraph where it reads that he, Job, was the greatest man among all the people in the East. Now, that is quite an accolade. And as we expect, he had all the things that we would normally associate with greatness. You know, he had wealth. He had connections, he had business ties, he had wisdom, he had family and meaningful relationships. But as we read closer, we will notice that these things were only the signs of his greatness, not the reason for his greatness. You see, Job's greatness lay in his inner person, not in his outer accomplishments. And as we will see, it wasn't the depth of his achievements, but the depth of his love for God that actually made him a great man. So before we unpack these keys of greatness from these opening words of this book, I want us to, I guess the question really needs to be asked, was Job a real or a fictitious person? You know, given that his name means hated or persecuted, and that he lived in this strange land called Uz, okay, which just sounds very unusual, we may ask, did this guy actually live? Did he really live? Well, in my view, Job really did live. I believe that he was a real person. Now, throughout the rest of the Bible, Job is listed along with Daniel and Noah as a man who actually lived. When Noah came out of the ark, he actually had a great grandson. His name was called Uz. His name actually means wooded, okay? And it's my view, it's my opinion that actually Uz settled in the ancient Near East, in the part of the world, I think, which would be near modern Jordan today. And though I can't, prove this, I'm of the opinion that actually Job came from the land of Uz, which was named after this guy called Uz. And I think actually he may have lived at the similar time to Abraham, about 4,000 years ago. And given that this book of Job contains some of the oldest words in the Hebrew language, it suggests that actually Job is actually one of the oldest books that we have in our Bible. And yet, As the oldest book in the Bible, it deals with some of the most profound and modern issues that affect us all today, every day. Job's life and the poetic discourse that he engaged with his three so-called friends, reveals one of the most profound and difficult questions that we all face. Why do bad things happen to good people? Job was a great man because through all his trials, he still had a love for God. And greatness in our lives is never developed through comfort and ease, but always through testings and trial. God allowed hardship. And he allowed hardship into Job's life. And often God allows hardship into our own lives because God is more concerned about the content of our character than he is about the comfort of our homes or the lives that we live. So given then that the measure of a great man or woman isn't in the depth of their achievements, but in the depth of their love for God, from the opening words of this profound book, what steps can we take to living a life of greatness? Well, I would say the first thing is that to live a great life, we need to develop a respect and love for God by putting him first. You know, it's telling that one of the first things that we should be informed about Job was that this man was blameless and upright. Now, it is a statement, a word, that the word for blameless here is used about 14 times throughout the scriptures. But on half of these occasions, it's actually used in the book of Job. And three times it specifically refers to Job. That Job was a man of integrity. That Job was a man of impeccable character. In fact, Job's blamelessness and his character was even vouched for by God himself, okay? On two separate occasions, God himself vouched that Job was a man of deep integrity. Now, I don't know about you, but when you go for a job application, normally one of the first things that is asked in that job application is the need for a character reference. And I would like you to imagine for a moment, imagine if you was to put forward the Queen as one of your references, and she was to vouch for your character. And let's imagine for a moment that actually she gave you a glowing report on her reference about your life. I think that would be pretty impressive, wouldn't it? That would go quite far. But imagine for a moment if it is God who gives you a character reference. How incredible would that be? And in fact, this is what is said of the life of Job. God himself vouched for Job as a man of integrity. And other than Jesus himself, as far as I'm aware of, no other person, maybe John the Baptist, no other person received such an accolade. And yet, Job, this man of integrity, was not immune from trouble. Now, how did Job develop such a character in his life? The answer is actually in the next few words of this verse. It reads that he feared God and shunned evil. Job had a healthy respect for who God was. He had a constant awareness of God's presence, and it caused him to make wise choices for his life. And those wise choices over the course of time formed his character. He loved to put God first. He put God first and he loved him. Now, I don't know about you, but have you noticed that we live in a culture today that sometimes is paranoid about being found out? Issues sometimes that were not taboo 20 years ago now are taboo. Things that were deemed off limits are now seen to be acceptable. Well, we live in a culture today where values of what is viewed as right and wrong is constantly changing according to the tide of public opinion. But I believe that if you live a life in a sense of fear and respect for who God is, if you put him first, if you seek him first, if you're honest with him and others, if you avoid sin like COVID-19, then actually you don't need to worry about the constantly changing tide of public opinion, because you realize that actually there's only one opinion that really matters, and that's God's opinion. Job feared God and he shunned evil out of his life. You know, the two go hand in hand. If you see God as holy, if you see God as someone who is deserving of our worship and our respect, if you see God as awesome and all-encompassing, if you worship him as the one and only, then you will begin to understand what is evil, and you will do everything to turn away from it. And if sin starts to look attractive in our lives, then we've got to ask ourselves, do we really respect God the way that we should? You see, the measure of a great woman or man is not in the depth of their achievements, but in the depth of their love for God. Greatness starts by respecting God and putting him first. The second thing I believe that we can learn from these opening words is turn away from evil by keeping short accounts. You know, on a long flight, an airplane only needs to be 1 degree off on the compass. And after so many miles, it could be hundreds, if not thousands of miles away from where it should be. You know, when you hear stories of money laundering or embezzlement, it usually happens because someone is not being honest with small amounts of money. There's no accountability as to where that money came from or what was been spent on. And then, but maybe small amounts, but then over a long period of time, a huge amount of fraud results. You see, in the same way, if we are just a degree off in our spiritual walk before God, if we allow, as it were, the little foxes just to come into our lives, before long, over a period of time, we can find ourselves in an incredibly precarious position. You know, the writer adds in this chapter that his sons, Job's sons, used to hold feasts in their homes on their birthdays, and they would invite their three sisters to eat and drink with them. Now, I hope you know that there's nothing wrong in having a party. There's nothing wrong in having food. There's nothing wrong in a drink or whatever. But we should all know that in that sort of environment, often things can be said, attitudes can surface, choices can be made that are sinful. But the writer adds of Job that when the period of feasting had run its course, that Job would make arrangements for them to be purified, thinking, perhaps my children have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. And this was Job's regular custom. You know, Job just was diligent in keeping short accounts with God, even on behalf of others. He was diligent just to keep short accounts in his life before God. And I want to say that given the measure of a great man or woman isn't in the depth of their achievements, but in their love for God, develop a healthy respect for God first. Love him first. Put God first. Keep short accounts with the Lord. But the third thing I believe that we need to do is value the dignity of human life by making intercession. You know, greatness is about putting people before possessions. You know, the writer says of Job's family that he had 7 sons and 3 daughters, but also of his property, he says he owned 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 donkeys, and he had a large number of servants. Now, for those of you who are familiar, have read the book of Job, you will know that right at the very end of the book of Job, after Job has endured all his hardships and his trials, and he's been questioning why all these terrible things have happened to him, at the end of the story, God restores everything back to Job that he had lost. He gives him, in fact, twice as many cattle and sheep and camels and donkeys. He gives him twice the amount of wealth than he had before. But something I find very interesting is at the end of the book of Job, he restored to him the same number of children that he had before. 7 sons and 3 daughters. And in fact, the Bible says that his daughters were the most beautiful daughters in all of the land. Now, I find that really interesting. Why did God bless Job with twice as much wealth at the end of his life, and yet gave him the same number of sons and daughters? And I believe the reason for that is because the value of sons and daughters is not in the same category as material wealth. Sons and daughters are made in the image and likeness of God. They are progenitors of God's glory. They are heirs of an inheritance. Animals and livestock are commodities. In the same way, as a human being, you are priceless. You belong to your heavenly Father. And your heavenly Father has given you a wonderful inheritance in the new heaven and new earth that he is soon to create. Your soul is not a commodity that can be bought with silver or gold, but your essence, your being, is priceless as one who is made in God's likeness. You are a person of immense privilege. And given that the measure of a great woman or man is not in the depth of their achievements, but in their love for God, one way that we express and demonstrate our love for God is through our love for those around us. In fact, when we start to see value in the people around us, of all people, regardless of all that, whatever background, and seeing the intrinsic value in themselves. Notice that after Job's sons and daughters had partied during the night, that he went out early in the morning and he would sacrifice a burnt offering for each of them. In other words, Job valued his children so much that he prayed for them. He interceded for them. He lifted them up before God in prayer. Can I encourage you that if you desire to be great, not for the sake of self-aggrandizement, but to be great in God's eyes as someone who leaves a mark in the world around you, intercede, pray regularly for those around you in your world. And so given that the measure of a great man or woman is not in the depth of achievements, but their love for God, to take some of those steps towards greatness, develop that healthy respect and love for God by putting him first, keep short accounts with the Lord, and turn away by turning away from evil. And thirdly, value the dignity of human life by making intercession for the people around you. You know, Jesus' disciples, who are having that incredibly immature and childish conversation among them as to who was the greatest, completely missed the point. They thought that greatness was about their achievements and efforts. But Jesus showed them that greatness is about losing our lives for something greater than ourselves. You know, Jesus said of John the Baptist that no one born of woman was greater. And yet he said that whoever is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than him. Jesus, as you know, was the greatest man who ever lived, because he came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. When teaching on the mindset of humility that leads to greatness, Paul said this of Jesus, who, being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used for his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself, and by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. We have seen this morning that Job's devotion to God, his care for his children to intercede and to pray for him, when he acted as a priest, as it were, to make sacrifices for his children, to cleanse them of their sin, was in some ways a mark of his greatness. But Jesus is greater than Job, because not only does he intercede, not only does he pray for you, but he is also the priest who laid down his own life for you so that you can have a relationship with God and know him as your heavenly Father. And that means that when we decide to turn away from everything that we know in our life is wrong, as we put our ongoing and continued trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, and if we haven't already done so in a faith act of obedience, go through the waters of immersion in Jesus' name and receive the Holy Spirit. When we take that step, when we take that first step, we can begin a journey in our lives where we understand that the measure of a great woman or man is not in the depth of their achievements, but in the depth of their love for God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we've taken board this message this morning, we realize actually that we're all challenged, including the preacher, that God, that we are all having to walk a path where we put you first, where we keep short accounts, where we value people before possessions. I pray, Heavenly Father, that you would shape, mold, and develop us to becoming the men and the women that you call us to become. And that, God, Lord, as we focus on you, as we focus on putting you first, that actually that you will make us into the people who leave a mark in the world around us. God, mold us to becoming great in your eyes. We ask these things in the beautiful name of Jesus. Amen. If this morning you have not yet come to that place of crossing that line of faith, putting your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm going to invite you just to pray this prayer after me. And that will be just your first step on your spiritual journey. Let's pray. Lord Jesus Christ, I'm sorry for the things I've done wrong in my life. And just right now, just take a moment maybe to ask for God's forgiveness and things that you know that you've done wrong. Please forgive me. I now turn from everything that I know is wrong. Thank you that you died on the cross for me so that I can be forgiven and set free. Thank you that you offer me forgiveness and the gift of your Spirit. I now receive that gift. Please come into my life by your Holy Spirit and live with me forever. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. If you've prayed that prayer for the first time, please drop me an email at info@mbconline.org and I will send you some details and endeavor to point you in the right direction. Hey, we're going to come around in a moment, around the breaking of bread after a short time of worship. See you in a moment. Bye.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness. great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter, springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses. Join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning. I see all I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin, peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father.
Welcome back. As we come round the breaking of bread this morning in our homes, I want to read to you a few verses of scripture from Matthew 27, and I'm going to read from verses 27 through to 31, and this is what it reads. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole garrison around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. When they had twisted a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and a reed in his right hand. And they bowed the knee before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." Then they spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they took the robe off him and put his own clothes on him and led him away to be crucified. You know, as we read those words, we see the worst of man, but at the same time, the best of God. These words reveal the darkness of the human heart and the human soul. And in many ways, though the actions of these soldiers upon Jesus were incredibly horrendous and evil, it also reminds us that actually in all of our hearts, there are aspects of uncleanness and even evil that we need to be aware of. You know, Jesus often spoke about the things in our lives that make us unclean: evil thoughts, adulteries, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, pride, foolishness. All these things have a residence in our heart to some degree or another. And actually, we see that the outworking of these evils were actually portrayed in the lives of these soldiers as they were persecuting and putting Jesus through the torment that he was experiencing. In the same way, our sin has actually afflicted Christ in that reading. And so as we take of the bread, as we take of the cup, we actually remind ourselves actually of the role that we played in Jesus' death. So let's just take a moment right now just to quieten our hearts before God, just to seek his face right now. Let's take of the bread. Let's just take up the cup as well. Let me read to you those words again. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus and the praetorian, gathered the whole garrison around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. When they had twisted a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and a reed in his right hand. And they bowed the knee before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." And then they spat on him, and they took the reed and struck him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they took the robe off him and put his clothes on him and led him away to be crucified. Lord, we thank you for your passion, for your suffering, for what you went through for us so that we can be forgiven. Thank you for the body of you that was given for us. Thank you for the blood of you that was shed for us so that we can have life in your name. Let us live in the forgiveness that you offer all of us through the work of the cross. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. See you in a moment. Well, thank you everyone for being part of our online worship service this morning. I hope you've enjoyed the time that we've had together around God's word and the breaking of bread. There will be a Zoom coffee morning after this online service. If you want to be part of that, just drop me an email at info@mbconline.org and I'll send you the details for that. Also, just to let you know, we have been starting a drop-in cafe every Sunday afternoon at 4 p.m. And we are in the process of just trying to get things started. We're trying to provide a forum for church members, people just to come together, grab a coffee, have a few light refreshments. And it's really the time just to try and build a bit of fellowship, get to know each other, make those connections of people. And in some ways, it's also a starting point as a precursor to what we'd hope to do in the future when things get back to some normality, whenever that will be. Now, if you want to be part of that, if you want to get booked in, this Sunday is already booked, but if you want to book in for next Sunday, please give a bell at the number below. Phone between Monday and Friday, and David will get you booked in, and who will arrange for you to be part of that coffee afternoon, or tea afternoon, or whatever you want that's been ordered. So please get your name down for that if you want to be a part of that, and that will be really good. Again, on our Tuesday night, we have a Bible study where we're continuing our teaching on angels and demons, and then we also have a prayer meeting after that as well. Hey, listen, thank you very much for being part of this time of worship, and I pray that God will watch over you, that God will bless you, and hope to see you soon, and have a great rest of the week. God bless you. Bye.